Hey guys, Chauncey Phillips here, my February 4th DVD update. We're talking about all the DVDs and Blu-rays I've gotten over the last 2 weeks or so. Like I always say, guys, enjoy these update videos. Definitely give this video a thumbs up. Leave me comments below what you guys thought of the titles I checked out and reviewed this update. And any titles coming up, as you guys like me to review for future updates, some of the things you guys have picked up recently. Now, the first one I got from Shout Factory, Scream Factory line, this is one that I was really interested in seeing. You know, I saw some pictures for this and always really love Natasha Lyonne and Chloe Sevigny, so really wanted to see this. It's a movie called Anti-Birth. It's one of these, like, really cool, exceptionally weird, strange movies. Like, everything about this is strange. Even the stuff that they play on the TV, these really strange commercials and odd, like, the ads for, like, this really weird, like, kids' family fun place with these really odd people in these weird suits and costumes and stuff. It is a very weird movie, but it's basically Natasha Lyonne and Chloe Sevigny's characters are going out all the time, partying, getting drunk, you know, blacking out drunk, not really remembering what had happened to them, doing all these kind of weird drugs that Chloe Sevigny's friend is selling to them. But one night, you know, Natasha Lyonne, like, kind of blacks out and totally doesn't know what happened to her. And right afterwards, she's showing all these signs of being pregnant, and she's having all these weird things happen to her. And she's like, I don't understand what happened. I don't remember sleeping with anybody for a really long time. How can I be pregnant? So she's like, not really sure what has happened. So she's trying to figure out what's going on. It deals with all these weird things. And, you know, Meg Tilly has come back to acting in the last couple of years. And it's like the first movie I've seen her in a long time. She was like in the Invasion of the Body Snatchers remake. And I think it might have been Moving Violations and one of the Psycho sequels, but a bunch of movies. I always really like Meg Tilly, and she's actually really great in this, playing this, like, kind of crazy conspiracy woman who's, like, always kind of lurking around in this movie, and she's trying to help out Natasha Lyonne figure out what happened, and she's kind of filling her mind with all these crazy things that she has to say and stuff. It is a very, very trippy, weird movie. I really, really love this. They both, of Natasha Lyonne and Chloe Sevigny together in this, are great as just these friends that are going around just kind of screwing around this whole movie. But if you want to watch, like, a really cool, weird, trippy horror movie, definitely check this out. Like I said, I really like this one a lot. As on here, though, some psychedelic shorts, storyboards, and a trailer on this one, but highly recommend this one. Next one from Universal is a movie called Loving. This is basically, I think this was set in like 1958. This is like dealing with the time when they had like laws in certain states about like if people like could only get married if they were the exact same ethnicity and things like that. So like there was no such thing, and they didn't allow mixed race marriages, all this kind of stuff. It was all the kind of terrible stuff that was going on back then. But it's basically about this couple that end up leaving the state to get married because I think they were in Virginia, and they go to, I think that's where they were. I think it might have been Virginia, but they leave their state to go to another state where it's legal to get married. And when they come back to where they live, like the police, like somebody ratted them out and like told that they got married, and they get in all this trouble because of this. And they end up arresting both of them and basically saying that this marriage cannot be, they cannot be seen together again, or they'll get thrown into jail. And basically what it comes down to is they have to basically, instead of, if they're not, to, you know, avoid going to jail, they have to both leave the state, cannot come back to the state together as a group, you know, as a couple married, no matter what. Otherwise they'd be immediately arrested. It's kind of them dealing with trying to figure out, you know, it deals with like the court cases and all that kind of stuff, trying to, you know, appeal this and kind of trying to change the whole thing and all the terrible stuff that was going on in the country then at the time, you know, with the marriages and segregation, all that kind of stuff going on. And that kind of is just, there's people too that really love each other, really want to, you know, be where they live and to be able to see their family, but they clearly cannot see their family again, and they're pregnant and want to, you know, have their family meet their child. It's just a very, very sad, you know, really, really well-done movie. You know, Joe Egerton is in this, and he was, you know, in The Guest and a bunch of different movies. I always really like him, and he had, like, an interesting look in this because he dyed his hair, like, real blonde and stuff. Definitely a real different look for him. But I don't know. I thought this was, like, a really, really well-done, like I said, but pretty sad movie, too, some, like, the stuff that was going on and happening to them. The next movie here, this is the 4K release from Lionsgate of John Wick. The movie with Keanu Reeves, the sequel is coming out, I think, like a week or two. I'm glad I got to finally see this one because I wanted to see this before the sequel came out. And I remember everyone was always talking about this, saying how cool this one was and, you know, how this was like a really huge thing for Keanu Reeves. And, yeah, I actually really like Keanu Reeves in these kind of roles. I think, like, these kind of, like, roles where he's, like, the really bad guy and stuff, he really plays that role well. Even in, like, you know, any even that, every, that's some of my favorite stuff. That, and then, of course, like, the Bill and Ted movies are, like, some of my all-time favorites. favorite of his. But this movie is basically, though, about John Wick, and he's like this guy who was a contract killer, and he got out of the whole thing and married this woman that he fell in love with and kind of, you know, erased that part of his life. He got out, was done with all that, wasn't being a contract killer or hitman for hire anymore. And what ends up happening, though, is his wife got very sick and died of cancer, and she left him this little dog, and that came, you know, after she died, this delivery company delivered this dog and said, you know, this dog will help you remember me, and maybe will help you be happy again. And he gets this little dog, and then there ends up being a break-in in his house, and these two guys end up killing his dog and then attacking John Wick. And basically, though, you know, these guys who did this are the kids of the guy that John Wick used to work for. It was a kind of a whole mix-up, and they had no idea that this was who this was that they did this to. And John Wick basically goes and wants to get revenge and the guys who killed his dog. And it's kind of him, you know, relentlessly going after them and, you know, trying to take them out and kill them. And it's like a total revenge movie that all really is based on this, his dog getting killed. I really like this one. It's a total insane music. It was kind of cool too. Like I haven't heard like Marilyn Manson music in a movie in a really long time. They had a couple of his songs in here. I don't know. I like I said, I really like, you know, Keanu Reeves in these kind of roles. I think he really does a good job of this, and really can't wait to see, you know, the next one. This movie too, I have to say, when it comes to 4K, I think this might be one of the best looking 4Ks I've seen, because this movie is a serious contrast film. There's a lot of real darks in this movie and a lot of like really cool colors and like the clubs and stuff that John Wick's character goes to. And you know, with the HDR, the high dynamic range, this those really pop and really have a good look in this. Like I said, to me, out of looking at all the few 4Ks that I've seen, this one to me definitely I would say is one of the best ones. The next one here from Lionsgate as well is a John Travolta movie called Life on the Line. This is an interesting movie because I had never really seen a movie about people who are, it's basically about power workers, you know, who work on power lines. And I don't think I've really ever seen a movie that deals with like power line workers before. At least as far as I can remember, you know, there's been like, no, I really couldn't think of any. But it's basically, though, about John Travolta. In the beginning of this movie, his brother ends up dying in a power line accident because there's like this storm and he gets electrocuted and dies. And it's a kind of him years later, and he's taking care of his niece, and his niece is getting ready to go to college. And it's kind of like him, and he's kind of like depressed, John Travolta's character, and really doesn't like this job anymore because he's kind of, you know, he knows how dangerous it is, and he loses friends in this, and he's also like trying to take care of his niece, and his niece starts to see this guy played by, you know, this boyfriend that you know, she's dating, and, you know, he ends up going and working it for the power line company that John Travolta's with, and he's really upset about this because, you know, the niece wants to go and stay there and not go away to college, and he's also afraid that this guy could end up dying in an accident. So it's like it deals with a whole, like, real heavy drama kind of thing about this, and you even see in the beginning of the movie a couple days till the storm is coming, so you know that there's going to be some big storm coming some point in this movie. So it's kind of the build up to that whole thing. And it's also like dealing with all these characters with their own set of problems and like family stuff going on in this whole job, which everybody is kind of knows is a super dangerous job. Like I said, it was a very interesting movie on a different subject matter that I really haven't seen before. The next one here, this is a movie called The Ninth Life of Louis Drax. And this was from the director of, you know, the you know, High Tension, The Hills Have Eyes remake. I always really like his movies. And he did Horns. This movie stars Aaron Paul. And it's, like I said, The Ninth Life of Louis Drax. And it's about, like, at the beginning of this movie, you see this, like, it's about this kid who is, like, really prone to having accidents, and they say he has nine lives because he keeps on having, like, all these things happen to him. He gets, like, stung by bees and has terrible reactions. He has all these terrible accidents. Things continuously, for some reason or another, keep happening to this kid. He's a real accident-prone kid. In the beginning of the movie, you hear narration of the kid saying, well, the one time I had my last terrible accident, and it's about him, like, falling off of this cliff, and you know something happened, too, with Aaron Paul's character, because like since the, you know, the first 10 minutes of this movie, Aaron Paul's character is kind of nowhere to be found, and you're kind of trying to figure out exactly what had happened, and the kid ends up going into a coma, and it has these trippy dream-like states of him like having these dreams, and it deals with his mother working with this guy who is kind of deals all with people in comas and is real like a specialist on all of this, and he's kind of trying to figure out what is happening to this kid and how he can end up waking this kid back up. And it all deals with these super trippy, like I said, dream sequences and these weird, like, thoughts and stuff like that. It is a very interesting movie that all kind of deals with, you know, dream states and all that kind of stuff. It was, to me, I thought it was a very different movie for this director, because, like, I think, because Horns and stuff like that, it was kind of on the line with Horns. You know, I liked Aaron Paul a lot in this one. Oliver Platt is in this movie, too, as the kid's therapist, because the kid also has all these problems, and it cuts throughout the movie, too, to, like, incidents and stuff like that that happened in the past with this kid. But definitely a pretty interesting movie, like I said, and it also has on here the making of the movie. And this one here, somehow I had never seen this before in my entire life. I had always, you know, seen the poster and, like, seen, like, the DVDs and stuff like that in the past, but never actually watched this. And I love Patrick Swayze, so I don't know how I didn't see this. Like, I think my favorite Patrick Swayze movie is Tu Wong Fu. Like, that was one, that and Ghost. But Ghost, to me, I can never watch that again. It's just too sad. There's some movies that are just, like, so sad, like Requiem for a Dream and stuff, that I cannot go back and watch. They're just, like, too much of a downer to me. This one's a real upbeat movie called Dirty Dancing. And this is the 30th anniversary, and I know, I cannot believe I didn't see this until now, you know. And I know, I think they're doing, like, a remake of this too, I think, and I think it has, like, Abigail Breslin playing Jennifer Grey's part, unless I might be totally wrong, but I'm pretty sure that's what I saw. But this movie's basically, though, about, you know, Jennifer Grey's character, who go, you know, she's with her family, and they go to this kind of, like, resort kind of camp, something like resort type camp where families go for the summer, and they go there for weeks, and they have, like, kind of activities and dancing and, like, all kind of different, just mainly lots of activities and a lot of dancing. And Patrick Swayze's there as, like, one of the dance instructors. And Jennifer Grey is kind of this girl. It's kind of about a coming of age thing too, for this girl, because she goes there and she's, like, trying to, you know, deal with being there for the entire summer. And she's kind of, like, a reserved, like, kind of to herself girl. And she sees, like, kind of Patrick Swayze's character, and he's, like, doing these, you know, teaching these dances, and she kind of becomes, like, you know, in love with him and, like, really likes him. And she starts going to, at night, like, the counselors at this camp, Patrick Swayze's character, they all have these kind of, like, crazy, you know, more out there type dancing for that time frame, because this takes place in, I think it was, like, the 50s. What's interesting about this movie too was, you know, it was set in the 50s or 60s, but like, there's scenes, like, when they're, like, dancing, like, they were doing some rehearsing scenes and stuff, Patrick Swayze and Jennifer Grey's character, and it's, like, you know, it feels like the 80s, and it's because, like, the look and the music, because it's got real 80s music. It's almost like when they go into that rehearsal spirit, I was almost, like, pretending, like, they take a time machine and go into the 80s, because it has this real 80s vibe to this. But, like, to me, it didn't take me out of the movie, but, like, I almost think they should have just had this movie set in the 80s, because it kind of, that was the only thing that I know I've seen a lot of reviews too, when people say that same thing about how it feels like the 80s. It doesn't really feel like the 60s or 50s when it was supposed to be. But basically, though, they kind of start to dance together, and for one reason or another, Patrick Swayze's dance partner, you know, has to go and do something else and can't, so she starts dancing with him, and it's kind of them, and he, you know, Patrick Swayze's character is not somebody who has a lot of money, and this girl comes with a family that's really rich, and, you know, the family doesn't like the idea of her with him, and she's passing judgments and stuff like that. It's just a really, really great love story, and just about this girl kind of coming age at this camp and dancing with him. And I don't know, I absolutely love this movie. I don't know how I hadn't seen this until now. It has a whole bunch of new features on here. Never before seen interviews with Patrick Swayze. And it was a pretty good interview. It was him kind of talking about, you know, these horses that he raised and all this kind of stuff that I never knew about him, like how he lived on this farm. And then it has on here, 30th anniversary salute with fans on here. Has a whole bunch of outtakes, deleted scenes, alternate and extended scenes is here as well as some cast interviews in here. But really cool brand new edition of this one. Now this is a show, I think it was on Epix, I think that's a channel this aired on. I was trying to figure out what it was on, because I didn't remember what it was on, and I don't know if there's going to be another season or not, but this, I know he got nominated, Nick Nolte got nominated for a Golden Globe for this one, and it's a show called Graves, and it's from Lionsgate as well. This is actually a pretty funny show, and it's like a different kind of, like, take on, like, a president, kind of like, it's basically Nick Nolte's, was a president in the 80s, and this is kind of like what the president does after he's the president, you know, when his term is up, and it's kind of like all the weird things that he's doing, because he's kind of like he's very depressed about his life, and he's not really happy because his wife is kind of making him go to all these kind of fundraisers and events and charity things, and like pretty much every single day he's booked to go to something like an opening of something or promoting some fitness thing or going to a school and talking to them about drugs or talking to them about all these kind of subjects. And it's kind of him kind of is like a dirty, mean-spirited president, ex-president, you know, and what he's doing now. And, you know, that's kind of pretty much what it is. I was watching through a couple episodes of this. It's actually a very funny show. Like, I really like Nick Nolte. Nick Nolte always plays, like, really good, like, crudge-mudgeny types. And he's in here, like, destroying his own museum, messing up, with, like, his pictures and artwork of himself because he's, like, really unhappy. It's kind of him in the beginning of the show, too, kind of having an awakening of trying to become happy again and how he's, like, tired and done with having to do all these events and stuff like that. It's actually, like I said, a pretty funny show. If you guys have seen this one, let me know what you think of that. The next one here from Lionsgate as well, this is a movie called American Pastoral, I think that's how you say it. And this one, I actually love this movie, and Ewan McGregor directed this, and has Ewan McGregor, Jennifer Connelly, and Dakota Fanning. This is one of those movies about, like, you know, they kind of supposed to be, like, especially at the beginning of the movie, it kind of starts, like, really typical, like, it's a real typical, normal American family, and it's, like, everything but that. And, it's basically in the beginning of the movie, this one guy is going to, like, his high school reunion, and he sees, you know, this picture of Ewan McGregor when he was, like, a young guy in high school, and he starts looking at it, and then he's kind of talking about, oh, yeah, I remember he was the coolest guy in the school, and he seemed like he had everything going on. He was on the football team. He had his, you know, his wife was a beauty model, you know, as a model. I think she was, like, Miss America, and she had, like, was really, like, everyone in school liked her. And he's, like, remembering this, and he starts talking to another guy at the reunion, and he's like, well, I'm going to tell you exactly what had happened to this family. You might not know. And he kind of tells this whole story about Ewan McGregor and, you know, his wife, you know, Jennifer Connelly and this, and their daughter. And the daughter was one of those kind of people that was all about, you know, not liking the system and not liking war and having all these kind of things, like anti-things, and she was always going to rallies and all this kind of stuff. And something ends up happening, and someone ends up dying in this explosion, and it ends up looking like the daughter might have had something to do with it, and that kind of throws the whole family into this total turmoil, and Jennifer Connelly's all cracked up in this and going crazy. This was an absolutely amazing movie. Like, I've seen some mixed reviews of this, and, like, I know this was based on a book that, like, it had really high reviews, but this was amazing. And, like, Dakota Fanning was so good in this. I mean, like, especially some of the stuff that happens to her in this. This was so, I can't tell you how good this was. This, like, to me, was, like, one of, like my favorite type of movies, because it's, like, really just, like, totally not what you're expecting to go happen in this at all. And, like, one of those things, too, you think about this a lot, especially what happens at the end of this movie. Like, you really think, I was really thinking about this movie, but highly recommend that movie. The next one here, this is a pretty cool, like, kind of concert documentary type film on Leonard Cohen. And I thought this might have been a newer one, but this actually came out in 2005 originally. Leonard Cohen recently passed away. It's a movie called Leonard Cohen, I'm Your Man. And I always love Leonard Cohen's music. I always think of it, like, number one thing I think of is from Natural Born Killers. Like, Natural Born Killers, his music fits so amazing to that. Like, it was in the opening credits, and I think one or two other times, I think at the end in the movie. But it really set the tone for that movie. Really had some really great music. And this is kind of a documentary on his life. It's kind of him talking about his life, and then it cuts in to scenes from from people like U2, Nick Cave, you know, Anthony and the Johnsons, Jarvis Cocker, and it's kind of them doing covers of Leonard Cohen songs. And it's like a pretty well done documentary just about his life and his origins and some of the songs and stuff like that. It has on here, though, a commentary track with the director in here, a conversation with Leonard Cohen, and then additional performances that were not seen in this version of the movie. But if you guys are a fan of Leonard Cohen and, like, kind of concert documentary type ones, definitely check this one out here. And the next one here from Lionsgate as well, this is a movie called The Crooked Man. And The Crooked Man, I think this, like, was a story that was known for a while. And I know they talked about The Crooked Man in The Conjuring 2. I'm pretty sure they talked about The Crooked Man, like, character. But this is basically, though, about this, beginning of the movie, though, these kids are messing around on this website. And they, like, go to this website called, like, The Crooked Man. And when they go to it, it, like, something ends up happening, and one of the friends ends up dying, and then the one girl ends up kind of blamed for this because they think that she was involved in killing her, so she ends up going to the insane asylum. And this is years later when she's 18, she gets out. As soon as she gets out, though, she kind of goes back to the friends, and like they're all kind of looking at her weird. The people in the town have kind of shunned her and don't want to talk to her, and like because they're looking at her like she was responsible for killing this girl. And it's kind of about a crooked man is coming back, because the crooked man like wants to get everyone that was like there that night, all the other kids, the babysitter in the house who was watching these kids, the pizza guy. He basically just wants to go and kill and take out all the people that were there that night, because I guess the crooked man, you know, wanted them all out in the beginning, but for some reason he only got one of them. So it's him now years later. And of course, though, the police, as soon as people start dying, are looking at this girl. It was actually a pretty cool movie. I think this aired on Sci-Fi, but I actually liked this a lot more than I thought, because you never know with like some of these kind of movies. But this one was actually, I don't know. I know it also has, you know, Michael J. White, you know, who was from Spawn. I believe he played Spawn in this. But it was actually a pretty good thing about this girl trying to figure out how she's going to stop the Crooked Man and kind of keep her from dying and stuff. The next one here, and I think this is a Lifetime movie. I'm going to say I cried to this movie. This was one of those kind of tearjerker movies, especially the end of this movie. And Marlee Shelton was in this movie. And I always loved Marlee Shelton because she was in, like, Bubble Boy. I think she was in Sugar and Spice. A bunch of movies. And this is the first thing I'd seen her in a long time. This movie is called Heaven Sent. It's about this couple at work at this kind of greeting card company, and they're in the midst of trying to sell the company because they can't work together anymore because they're having all these arguments, and they're thinking about getting separated because they're really not happy with each other anymore. And they end up like just on the cuff of, you know, signing the papers to get separated, and weird things start to happen. Like the accidents happen, like, you know, ink spills on the paper so they can't sign the divorce papers, or like they blow out the window. But basically what happens is this girl gets sent down from heaven to try and stop them and help them and try and save their marriage. And it was actually pretty good. Like, you know, Ernie Hudson's in this movie as well. And it's not really a religious movie, though. It's more just like the idea of someone coming to try and help them, like this angel coming to help them. And it's kind of funny, too, because, like, you know, since she's like an angel, like no one else can see her. So, like, calling the police, like, oh, this little girl wandered up at their house, and we have to try and find their parents. And there's like some kind of funny stuff of like they're telling the police and like talking to this girl, and the girl is, you know, invisible to everybody but this couple. I don't know. I thought this was actually really great. And I'll say, too, I was not expecting what happens in this movie at all. And like I said, this is a total tearjerker movie. Like, it was pretty bad. It was like a real, I have to not lie too. I love these Lifetime movies. I don't know what it is. I've watched so many of these Lifetime movies. They're very, very watchable movies. They're usually positive, and I can see why they have such a huge viewership. They're just really well done. And this one was actually very well done. I love this one. Like I said, too, I was really happy to see Marlee Shelton in something again, too. The next one here from Paramount is a movie that I believe this is up for Best Picture. I'm pretty much 100% certain it is. It's a movie called Arrival. This is the 4K edition of this one, and I was glad to watch this again, because when I watched this in the theater projected this movie too dark, like, and they never fixed it. Like, everyone kept going out and telling them, and it was like, you couldn't really see this movie for some reason, because it's a very, very dark movie, and if it's projected wrong, you wouldn't be able to see it at all, and that's kind of what happened when I saw it. But it's, like, got a really great atmosphere to it, because it is super contrast, and super dark, and super, like, they really went for a specific gloomy look with this movie, because it definitely has a very, very, very gloomy kind of vibe to this. And especially just like, it's also a movie too that's all kind of played all out of different kind of sequences and stuff too, because you're like, when is this happening? When is that happening? I can't figure out when this is. And it's basically about Amy Adams, who goes to try, she's like a translator who can read different languages and stuff. And these weird spacecrafts, like this ship ends up in the middle of the desert in these different kind of spots. And she's kind of brought in with the army to try and kind of crack the code of how to communicate with this spacecraft, because they go inside of it, and there's these aliens in there, and they're kind of putting squid ink up into the sky of these weird type words and shapes and stuff, and she's there trying to crack the code of what they're saying, and try and figure out if these aliens mean harm, and if they're going to kind of kill them, or kind of, you know, start a war. And it's kind of her just there trying to figure out what all this means, and she's there working with Jeremy Renner, who's like work, who knows like how to read the things as well. And it's just an interesting movie. Like I said, it's got a really cool like vibe of what's going on. It's a definitely a slow burn movie, but a different take on alien movies. And I really liked the music in this. This movie had really, really cool music. And like I said, this is definitely one too that looks really good on 4K. And like I said, I was really glad to look at this again because the way I saw it in the theaters just was not the right way to see this. Because like I said, if this was projected wrong, because like I said, this is definitely on the cuff of like super dark. You know, you could never like, you know, couldn't see it very well if you saw it projected wrong. But it has a number of different featurettes on this movie on here. The thing on here with the sound design and the score, but very, very cool movie here. The next one here from Sony is one called Spin Out, starring Xavier Samuel. And he was in like that one movie. I can't remember what it was, like that horror movie. He's done a bunch of different movies, Plush and stuff like that. But it's a movie called Spin Out. This is an Australian film. This is basically, I've never seen the movie about this kind of thing, because it's kind of like about a group of people who go to like this kind of race thing they have out in the middle of like kind of like this desert type area where like a bunch of friends, a huge group of people kind of get together and they do kind of like car stunts and like spin the car around and do all these kind of car tricks and stuff like that. And they've kind of been like a group of these friends that have been kind of doing this together for years. They're kind of at this age now and they kind of have to grow up and they go away to school and kind of figure out what they're going to do with their lives. They kind of can't keep doing this. And Xavier Samuels' character really likes this one girl, but they kind of like really are not admitting it to each other. And she's like saying after, because like Xavier Samuels' character does like this really crazy stunt that like doesn't really go well and really could have killed him. And she's like, you know what? I can't deal with you anymore. I can't deal with you like this crazy way you're acting anymore. I'm going to leave. I'm getting out of here. And he has to try and figure out what he wants to do with his life and if he wants to be with her and if he wants to try and change. And it was actually a pretty interesting thing. Like I said, I've never really seen a movie that deals with this kind of event that they have. I don't know if this is actually like an event they really have in Australia, these kind of stunts and spinning things that they do, but a pretty interesting one here. The next one here from Sony as well is a movie called Baby, Baby, Baby. And this is about, kind of like about one guy who was an actor and he was like an artist and an actress. And it's like these kind of couple that come together. And it's one of those kind of things, how they met. And it's like one of those movies where it kind of like, they're kind of almost like self-destructing each other's relationships. You know, like things are going really well, but then one person does one thing and they're kind of like just about to end up breaking up and they're kind of trying to figure out if they're going to be able to save their relationships and like figure out how to like, you know, kind of make everything work. And it's pretty much just a relationship thing all set the backdrop of these two people that are trying to kind of make everything work. I thought it was okay. And the best of about this one though was there was some really cool sequences when the one guy decides he doesn't want to, thinks he might not want to act anymore and he might want to go into writing, and he's like kind of thinking up these weird stories, and they get all these celebrity cameos in it, like when he's kind of, they're reenacting the scenes that he was writing, so like these dinner scenes, and they had like who was in this one? It was like so many different people kind of pop up in this. I can't remember. I think it was like William Shatner and Jessica Alba and a bunch of different people and all these celebrity cameos in here. There's tons and tons of cameos in this movie. The next one here from Sony as well is a movie called The Eagle Huntress. This is a really well done documentary. The cinematography in this is amazing. Probably some of the best cinematography that I've really seen in a long time. Like, it was just so well filmed. It's one of those things too, where it's a documentary, but it almost feels like a real, like real, like it wasn't, like it was all planned and stuff, just because of how well it was all executed with how it was shot. And it's kind of about these out in, I think it was out in like Appalachian Mountains, I think. I can't remember exactly where the area exactly was, but it deals with the idea of hunting with, was it an eagle? I think this was basically, I'm pretty sure it was it. Yeah, it was actually kind of the eagle, but it's basically with hunting with eagles to kind of like catch, you know, the prey and stuff like that. And it deals with how normally it's like the family like would train a boy to do this, but it's like this girl who really wants to do it. And it's kind of like never really done like that, but like this girl's family is okay with this. And it's about them kind of going out with her to get her first eagle and kind of filming the whole thing of trying to help her train this eagle. And it's just, that's pretty much what it is. It's just a really great character piece documentary. Really, really well filmed. Like a really positive, you know, nice movie. really, really like this one a lot. If you want to see like a super well-filmed, you know, amazing cinematography documentary on a kind of a subject matter too that I really don't feel like I've seen anything on this before, and a really great setting and everything. But it has on here though a commentary track on here and a featurette on the movie. But like I said, really, really cool documentary here. The next one from Sony, and I found out later this one is a sequel. I think the first one was like Cross something or other, but I don't think you really need to have seen the first movie to see this one. It's a movie called Cross Wars. And it's kind of got like a sort of like a Power Rangers, kind of like more R-rated type Power Rangers kind of vibe to this one a little bit, because it's like this guy, like Brian Austin Green's character, has like this amulet that gives him like these super type powers, and it's kind of dealing with him and his group of like these people that work for him that kind of take out bad guys. And you know, it's Danny Trejo's character who, because of one thing that happened, like really wants kind of to take out Brian Austin Green and all the people that work for him, and kind of like wants to get like revenge on him and kill him. And it's Brian Austin Green's character is like tries to work with these group of these girls, kind of form this whole group of like, you know, to take out the bad guys and stuff. Just a real crazy, off the wall. It kind of has like a Spin City, you know, Sin City type vibe to this a little bit, mixed with like a spy type movie, like I said, mixed with like an R-rated type Power Rangers. There's just like a real crazy one was like where people were like getting shot and killed every second in this. These crazy off the wall, crazy sequences in this movie. As on here though, Brian Austin Green, Tom Sizemore, Vinnie Jones, and Danny Trejo in this one. Now this one here, this is one of those shows I watched through the entire, I think it has 9 episodes. It was one of those ones I absolutely like was addicted to. It's like, I have to finish this show. I don't know when the second season comes on. I know it's a show too where they filmed both the seasons back to back, and there's only ever going to be 2 seasons from what I read. It's a movie with Danny McBride and Walter Goggins called, I'm going to show with Walter, you know, Danny McBride and Walter Goggins called Vice Principals. This is the complete first season. This was so funny and such a great thing. I'm glad I watched this, you know, before I had the gallbladder surgery, because now if I laugh, it's going to be a little while, like I kind of get like that pain. So I was like, I'm glad I watched this before. It's a very funny thing, and it's you know, written and directed by the director of Observe and Report, and he also did Eastbound and Down. I loved Observe and Report. I know some people didn't like that movie, but like that, I love these kind of mean-spirited kind of comedies. And it's basically though about these two vice principals of the school. In the beginning of the show, Bill Murray's like the head principal and ends up leaving the school because his wife is really sick, and they kind of, both these principals are thinking, well, one of the vice principals is thinking, one of us is to become the head principal of this school. And they're kind of like start off kind of with a, you know, dispute about each other and kind of fighting for who's going to win. But of course, though, they bring in this new woman to be the head principal of the school, and they have to continue being vice principals. So they want to work together to find out how they're going to take out this woman and kind of take her job. And they're kind of like doing heinous stuff, like, you know, screwing up the school and burning down her house. This happens in the very first episode, second episode of the show, so there's no spoiler, but burns down her house and like messes with, like, oh, they're relentless. And it deals in this show with all kind of school problems, like going on this field trip and just having all these kind of issues. And Danny McBride's character really likes this one teacher at the school, and he's trying to get with her. It's just a very, very mean-spirited, super funny show. You know, real R-rated. Like, I love these kind of things. And Walter Goggins and Danny McBride together, like, their stuff, they are so good together in this. And Walter Goggins plays such a strange principal in this, too. I don't know. This was absolutely hilarious. It has on here, though, deleted scenes, a blooper reel, and commentary tracks on the episodes. And the next one here from, this is from a Cinemax release, but this is from HBO as well, though, through Cinemax. This is the complete first season of Quarry. This is one I started watching this. I watched a couple episodes of this. And this is about a guy who comes back from Vietnam. And, like, this is about, too, like, something really bad that happened in Vietnam about, like, these kids that died. I didn't know too much about the whole PASTA thing, but they talk about this a little bit in the show. But it's basically, though, he comes back from Vietnam, and these guys are kind of following him around, him and his friend, and they want to kind of recruit him to be a hitman for them, and they want to pay him all this money to be, like, go on hits for them and kill certain people for them. he doesn't want to do it, but he ends up kind of roped into this because his friend takes the money, and his friend, the first episode, something he dies, and he kind of now has to do this, or these group of these people are going to kill him, kill the guy, and it's kind of him going on these hits, and he's also dealing with a lot of post-traumatic stress because of what happened in the war, and this is like the last thing he wants to do is having to go out and kill more people, you know, especially with all the kind of problems he has going on. Very, very well done thing. Like I said, just started watching through this one, but really pretty cool show here. Has on here, though, behind-the-scenes interviews, commentary track, music videos, deleted scenes on this one. But really cool show. If you guys have seen this one, too, let me know what you thought of this and what you guys thought of Vice Principals. The next one here from Fox through the National Geographic is a movie called Killing Reagan. I remember I watched this one a couple months ago on the gym because I saw it when it was on TV. It's about the guy that right after Reagan became, you know, took the White House, he ended up getting, you know, shot and by this kind of crazy guy. And I think the guy in real life now just got out of jail recently. I can't remember what his name was, but he ends up, you know, getting shot. And it's kind of about Reagan, like right after this happens, trying to deal with this and dealing with how he's going to do like his presidential duties and stuff like that right after this has happened to him. And it also deals with like the guy that tried to kill him and what's going to happen to him. It's a pretty well done thing. It has, you know, Tim Matheson playing Reagan and Cynthia Nixon playing his wife. I think it was just Tim Nixon plays the wife, I believe. But this was actually, like I said, a pretty well done movie on the whole thing. Number two, when this aired, they were having like a lot of talking about that on the TV and stuff. The next one here from Dark Sky Films, this is Stakeland 2. And after I watched this, I was like, I don't know if I actually saw the first movie. And I don't know why I never watched it, because I know Daniel Harris was in it. But I don't know how I somehow missed this. And this is basically a vampire film about this kid, like the first movie, because they should flash back to some of this, kind of had to go and hunt these vampires. And this is like years later, and the guy who was like with him has vanished, and he wants to try and find him again. And there's like this is one of those vampire movies too, which is like a kind of like has the vibe of Near Dark, more in that kind of vibe mixed with like Dusk Till Dawn a little bit. And it's basically about this kid kind of traveling across the vampire like outback kind of middle of nowhere area, going through this area with all these vampires everywhere, trying to find where his mentor is and try and work with him again. And it's kind of like just him going from place to place with all these weird vampires, and like you never really know who you can trust to, because like no one is like shortage of food, and people who are not vampires, you know, you don't know if they're going to try and eat you. It was pretty well done. The best stuff too in this was it was actually really, really well filmed. I need to watch the first movie. I don't know how I totally missed that one, but this is actually, if you guys want to see a pretty cool vampire movie though, this definitely was a very cool vampire movie. It has on here though a making of and a trailer on this one. The next one here from Severin Films is a killer animals movie, which I had never seen or heard of before, called Wild Beast. There's a crazy thing in the beginning too, and they were like feeding, and like I don't know if they really feed this to like these lions and stuff. In the beginning they were feeding like a horse head to them. It was really very gross, the stuff in the beginning, because like a horse head, and I kept, it was one of those things, once you saw it you couldn't stop thinking about that. Like, man, did they really feed? I don't think they do, but like, did they feed that to those kind of like animals back then, like horse heads and stuff? Like, I'm like a full horse head. It was like, whoa, this is really creepy. But it was like, basically though, at this zoo, something is happening, and like the animals are all starting to attack the people who are there, and it's got a guy who's kind of trying to figure out exactly what has happened, and this girl who's working with him, and she kind of photographs animals and stuff. But it's just a crazy like killer animals movie. They made a lot of these kind of movies around this time. This is from 83, but they did like The Day of the Animals, I think it was like a 70s one, a couple other killer animals ones, like one with a bear and stuff. I always like these kind of crazy animal attack movies, and has some pretty cool synth music in this as well. But if you guys want to see like a killer animal movie that I feel like really doesn't get talked about much, like I said, I had never heard of this one before, definitely I would say check this out. It has on here though, interview with the director on here, interview with the editor on here, and an interview with the animal wrangler. That's one thing too, is there's some amazing scenes of the animals, like scenes with these like elephants attacking, and it's this kind of stuff that I had never seen before. Because, you know, if they did this show now, it would all be CGI'd and stuff. But back then, they were actually really training these animals, getting them to do this stuff. It was a very crazy movie. The next one here from, you know, the Warner Archive, it's a movie called When Dinosaurs Attack. When Dinosaurs sort of Ruled the Earth. And this is also the uncut international version, because I think this was like released in the U.S. is like a G-rated movie, but this one is definitely would be more PG-13 R-rated, because there's like a lot of nudity in this version, a couple different scenes. And this one is called When Dinosaurs Ruled the Earth. It's one of those dinosaur movies too, like a caveman movie, where it's all like no actual dialogue. It's all caveman talk, like boop boop boop, goosh goosh, and all these kind of weird words and stuff like that. But it's kind of about, in the beginning of the movie, it's like this whole colony of like blonde women where they like, you know, sacrifice them to the gods, anyone who has blonde hair, and she ends up falling off this cliff and surviving and getting taken in by these cavemen. And the one caveman kind of starts to like her, and it's kind of the caveman community kind of gets all up in arms when this woman arrives there. And there's all these weird things that too that are happening with the sun, and like big huge like sun rays coming down and stuff. It's a very weird movie, but it's kind of her and this like this community, and then the people that were trying to sacrifice this woman, they're trying to come after her and find where she is. And there's all these crazy stop motion like puppet like dinosaur scenes, which were really well done. Like, and a couple of them I was thinking, is that like a real lizard they were filming again with a green screen? Like, because like if you guys have seen this one, it's like really well done for the time. This is, I think, filmed in 1969. Like, pretty cool. Like, I mean, it's kind of cheesy look though, but it was actually pretty cool. It was weird too. I looked up the one woman who was like the main woman in this, and I was like, found out now she's incarcerated and been in jail like for trying to kill somebody. And then 2011 was like a crazy thing to find out, because I was trying to look up the people and see like what other stuff they did. It's always weird when you find out that kind of stuff. But, you know, a really, really great picture quality on this one. And if you guys like these kind of like animal, like, you know, dinosaur type movies, I would definitely say this one's a really cool, worth watching one. The next one here is from Sony. This is kind of weird to watch because, like, I hadn't seen this since this was like, it was like 1997 or something like that. And it was the Teletubbies Big Hugs. This is very, very weird to watch this again. I remember too when this came out, this is just a very trippy, weird show. And it was for kids, but a lot more adults were watching this because it was just weird. It was like, what is happening here? This is just an off the wall, odd thing that these weird creatures, and like, they like project images of like kids, and like, you know, basically if they want to show like a video like they did in shows like Arthur and stuff, they'd have a projection of like the Teletubby's stomach, and they cut to like the video of the kids doing like a school thing or showing like projects and stuff like that. And you see like the like a creature and like a someone in the sky, which is like a big baby watching them. It's just a very weird one. This has a bunch of different episodes on this one. The next one here from Full Moon is the second episode of the Raven Wolf Towers series. This is actually a pretty cool series. They have, this is like a thing that's on their Full Moon streaming service. And then they're releasing the DVDs of this as well. I don't know if they're due down the line too. Like I feel like they might, I'm not sure, like cut them all together into a movie at some point too. But right now they're releasing, you know, all the movies, you know, all the episodes on separate DVDs as well, or through their streaming service. And this second one, it's actually a pretty cool series. It kind of has an American Horror Stories hotel kind of feel to this one. And it's also kind of reminds me of like the early Puppet Master ones too. It's definitely a real throwback to them, because they even bring back some of the characters and stuff like that, you know, from past Full Moon movies. It's basically about a guy who has come to work at this hotel and kind of clean the place up and stuff. And he's like noticing all these weird things. Like, there's a really weird family there. Like, these people that have these weird teeth, and this one woman who's like younger than the mother, and they're calling, you know, like the mom, like it's like a 20-year-old woman, and the one who's like is calling her the mother, and it's a much older woman playing the daughter. It's a very weird, trippy thing. And they're like killing all the people that kind of come there and torturing them and doing all these weird things to them. It's just a weird thing with a whole lot of odd stuff going on in this, you know, apartment type building. I really like this one. I definitely look forward to seeing the other episodes and kind of how this whole thing goes out. I'm not sure how many episodes are going to be in this as a whole series though. And the last one here from Mill Creek, and this is like a cool, they put out this whole set. I believe there's going to be a Blu-ray version of this one as well. And this is Quantum Leap, the complete series. And they're in here like this, for those wondering. It's all, how many, it's like 76 hours of Quantum Leap. And it's, you know, season one, and they're all just like this in here. And the last, let me see how many seasons are in here. It's season five. So this is one for five seasons. This is pretty much like a time travel type show. And it's basically about the guy who can kind of like travel back and like fix people's kind of past when they had bad things happen, goes back to events and tries to kind of fix, you know, things that had kind of gone wrong and stuff like that. It's actually a pretty cool time travel show, but it's kind of cool though to have them all together like this. And like I said, I believe there's going to be a Blu-ray release of this one as well. But anyway though, guys, that was all for this Blu-ray update. Thanks again for watching and subscribing, guys, and for all your support, and I'll see you guys later.